Hello everyone, today 7 of A Taste of Quilting, and today I'm going to show you how you do the quilting, which is the three layers of sewing through the three layers. I'm going to take 2 days to tell you how to do this. The first day today we're going to do the basic, the easy technique, which is called stitch in the Dutch, which is basically invisible stitching, quilting. The second technique I'm going to show you tomorrow is something that's called big stitch. It looks a little bit like sashiko. It can be done with embroidery thread, and it's a more embellishment kind of quilting. I'm going to do it based on a circle quilt pattern because one of the followers was wondering how to do that because one of the first students of mine has done it. And I want to show her how it's done. Today you won't be seeing my face but my lap. First, I'm going to show you the technique, and after that, I'm going to talk a little bit about the different meanings of the word quilting. Because quilting, I noticed that it's a little bit confusing because the perfectly fine sentence, a quilt, a quilt, a quilted quilt, is confusing to people who don't know quilting. So basically, let me start. A quilt is, technically speaking, from origin, a thing with three layers that I sewn through. It's historically a quilt is also used for armor, for example. It was like an extra soft layer soldiers would wear to make the harness less uncomfortable, and it also is a good way to make warm stuff because if you have three layers and you put wool inside, it's warmer, and you quilt through it, like meaning sewing through the three layers, because that means that the three layers will stay together and that it's stronger. Quilting comes from the Latin word "quilcita," which means wetted bag, basically, which is also by some people believed to be the predecessor of the mattress. And if you look at it, a mattress is also three layers that are sewn through. So from a bag that was used to sleep on as well as a mattress, it became the wonderful art objects they are now. And that kind of makes sense because one of the things I love about quilting is that it's a way to have beauty into the everyday life. Because I think quilting shows a deep sense of humanity where people, whenever it's possible, make things pretty. Even if it's only like useful objects. Even in prehistoric time, there is proof that people had a lot of decorative objects, even though they were traveling people. So I think quilting is one of those things that shows the human nature of wanting pretty things to have in your day-to-day life that mean something to you. Because yes, a quilt is super practical because it's warm, it will keep you warm, it's durable, and all of those things. But the quilt also has endless opportunities to make something beautiful. And that combination of beauty in everyday life as essence of humanity, I love that. I think it's very beautiful. And also it makes me hopeful because if one of the essence of humanity is wanting to have pretty things in your life, I think there's a way out of the mess we're in now. So that's the origin of the word quilting. A quilt is the finished object with three layers, but it can also have two layers, but usually it has three layers. So you can actually say a quilt is a finished object with several layers that are sewn through. And you have a million techniques for that. I won't go into now because it will be too much. I will send you an email with an article about the term as well, where you can learn some more. I actually have a quilt library online that is freely accessible with a lot of information on quilting if you want to know more. Quilting is both a container term for the whole process of quilt making. So, but technically speaking, quilting is sewing through the three layers, as we are going to do today. And then the sewing the pieces together to a quilt top is called patchwork. So technically speaking, there are different terms, but they're used interchangeably, and it depends a little bit on the country and whether it's like a people who know about quilting or not, how specific they made each part of the quilting process. So in our case, in the Kick-Ass Quilt community, I just call everything quilting. And you can make more clarifications if you want, but I don't want to confuse you too much about terminology. And lastly, that also means that a quilter is somebody who participates in any part of the quilting process. So that can be preparing fabrics, that can be making the quilt top, and it can be sewing through the layers, and it can be putting on the binding. So again, technically speaking, a quilter is somebody who makes the three layers together. And there are actually people who are professionally quilters. You have machines for it and you can do it by hand. But often people use the term quilter as a general term for anyone who makes a quilt. And then making the quilt top, which is called patchwork with the design we use now, that's called piecing. So if you see the term piecing and quilting in quilting blocks or whatever, you know that piecing is the quilt top, quilting is making the three layers go together. And there is a difference in techniques and skills needed for both steps, but if you're just a very enthusiastic person or you just don't focus too much on perfection, you can do all the parts of it yourself. But it's just good for you to know that there are different kind of things. I think that are all the terms you need to know now. If you still have questions about it, you can let me know. Now I want to dive into how the quilting works. You have a piece of thread. We are going to stitch in the ditch, which means that you're going to quilt through the seams. This is a quilting technique that is nearly invisible and that helps you to create a quilt has sort of the feeling of little pillows on it. That's what I love about quilts. And if you stitch in the ditch, you don't see the quilting, but you will have that pillow effect and the quilt will turn a little bit 3D. You can also go lightly away from the ditch, like half a centimeter or so, then you also have the pillow effect, but then your quilting is visible. And today we're going to discuss invisible quilting. And tomorrow we're going to discuss visible quilting. And I'm discussing both with you because I usually like invisible quilting if the fabrics in your quilts are very important. Because with invisible quilting, your fabric comes out in the best way possible. For example, I have a coaster here and it has stitched in the ditch, and in that way it's very easy to see the glittery fabric, which is a hairband I had as a kid. And if you stitch on the fabric more, it's less visible. I will show you an example tomorrow. Quilting is also done traditionally with small stitches of about 1 or 2 millimeters, which is very tiny. But you can also decide to have bigger stitches, then it's called big stitch. Try to make it even. Even if your quilting stitches are like half a centimeter, it's still okay as long as it's even. And by practice, your stitches will grow smaller. I don't want you to worry about the sizes of your stitches. Just try to be even and stick around half a centimeter if you struggle with making them small. If you want to start quilting, you take a piece of thread that's around 20 to 30 centimeters and you make a normal knot in it at the end. Like this. I don't know if it's... Nah, the camera won't work very well. But you make a knot at it. Then you take your fabric and you start at an edge. And you make sure that your needle goes under the fabric, in between the batting and the quilt top, and you go up about half a centimeter from the border, because you remember that's where your pattern starts. And you gently pull the thread through, and then you will notice that the knot will get stuck if you don't pull too tightly. That's what's supposed to happen. That's how you secure a quilt stitch. Then you start stitching by going through all three layers. If you want, you can secure your stitch at the beginning, but it's not a must, but I usually do. by also going back through all the layers. Like this. You go through all three layers because quilting is sewing through the three layers of a quilt. And then you just follow the line by making stitches of about half a centimeter. I wouldn't try to make them much bigger, but again, evenness is more important than smallness. And then you just go through the seam. And that's the basis of how you quilt a quilt. And this process can take like, you can do it by machine as well, of course. Any part of the quilting process you can do by machine as well. Although I also noticed that a lot of people really enjoy doing this by hand because it's very relaxing, but it can take you a while. But then again, we're not in a hurry. Especially if you follow tomorrow's class, you will notice that you can add a lot of artistic designs elements to your quilt with the quilting. It's something lovely to explore. And as you notice, I'm going up and down. I don't do several stitches in a row. You can, but if you're a beginner at sewing, it's better not to, because then you have control over your needle. And if you look at the back, you see that the line is appearing. I should have actually used a bolder color, but I didn't want to make my quilt look strange. And usually you do stitching around, if you have something like this with like 2.5-3 centimeter blocks, usually it's good to stitch around all the ditches. But if your quilt blocks are smaller, it's not necessary to stitch through all of it. Quilting is what makes the quilt strong. So the amount of stitches you do really depends a little bit on the purpose of the quilt. For example, if it's a quilt that will be used as a baby blanket, which will be heavily used, it's good to use more quilting than if it's like something you just hang somewhere and will be not used a lot. So this is how you quilt a quilt. And the benefit of making a small coaster is also that it's much easier to start learning how to quilt with a smaller quilt rather than a bigger one. And if you go to the end, usually I like to go to the back to end the thread. You make a little knot again. And then we go to do something that's called bury the knot. You're going to go into the fabric in between the backing and the backing where you came up. You go a little bit further on, then you slowly pull the thread until you find the knot, and then you pull the knot through. And then your thread is secured. You can cut it and start again at the next spot. Don't make your thread too long. I usually do, and I always regret it. Okay, I have a new thread because it was too short to still do a piece with. You make a knot. You go to where you want to start. For example, here. You go under it. You go up. You check if it's secure and see it doesn't move. Then you can start quilting. And like I like to do, make an extra stitch to the back to secure it extra, but you don't have to, like this. And then you start sewing again. And again, evenness is more important than small stitches. Because small stitches is something you will get better at in time. You know what's interesting to notice? I was actually very tired before this live session. But now I've started quilting, I notice I start to relax. So maybe quilting is what I needed. I had a very hectic week arranging things for Kick-Ass Quilts, like meeting with people, checking workshop rooms. I'm going to start to plan. I'm also organizing a festival where I live with somebody where quilting is going to be the main act. So we're going to make some stuff to show at the festival. The location is an old camper and we're trying to make it look pretty. And we were working on that today. So I've been creative all day, but not with quilts. And I was very tired because I'm an introvert, so I love meeting new people, but at some point I really feel the hermit urges grow and grow and grow. And I noticed that now I started quilting, I'm actually getting very relaxed. So if you're like me and you get tired of meeting people and arranging stuff, give yourself 30 minutes a day to quilt. And I'll promise you that you will find yourself relaxed more. Just pick a moment in your day, tune in my sessions, quilt with me, and find relaxation while you make beautiful stuff. And know that the quilting stitches I make are quite big, but I want to show you that perfection is not necessary. Just, you know, you had Van Gogh, the painter. The sizes of his stitches depended on how his mind was doing, and apparently my stitches are bigger when I'm restless, and I was restless, and as I said, I had a very tired day today with meeting a lot of people, and what I want to say is, if you notice that your stitches are not very small because of whatever reason, just embrace it. Like, then a quilt tells the story of you and your life as well, eh? So sometimes in your life you have moments where you're less restless, and sometimes you have moments in your life where you're very restless. And I kind of like the idea that it's visible in the quilts you make, because quilts are a reflection of who you are. So you don't have to stop quilting when you cannot do it to perfection or when you're a little very tired. Actually, what I'm learning now is that I should quilt when I'm very tired, because it calms me down. But it's not the smallest stitches, but that doesn't matter, because the quilt reflects the quilter, and me as a quilter, I am a combination of calm and restless. And I invite you too to just embrace the moment and see, quilt anyhow, and let the life you have transform itself into a quilt. I think also that turns into the most liveliest quilts anyhow. So yeah, you can really try seeing quilting as a process to embrace fluctuations in your life and imperfection, because you cannot be the same every day and you cannot act in the same way every day. Like, some days you work better for you than other days. Same in creativity, but I think it's a shame to stop being creative because you feel not fantastic in a certain day, because sometimes it's the healing you need. So yeah, that's my invitation to you.
I really love imperfect quilts because they always have such a life of their own. Yeah. That makes that quilt tell story. I have a quilt where I hid a little bit of a scarf that reminded me of one of my big loves. And when I hid it in my quilt, it's actually my dear Jane. We were broken up, and I think it was the first heartbreak I ever experienced, and I also think the worst heartbreak I ever experienced. And he still is one of my big loves, I think, and I missed him so much that I had a scarf that reminded me of a shirt he had, like a red tartan. And I bought it at some point, but at some point I was getting a little bit over the heartbreak, but still I love that guy. And I put a part of that scarf in the quilt, so I could like put that feeling somewhere comfortable, but also still not completely let go of somebody because I couldn't. And also it was a way for me to keep that guy in the quilt without it being obvious, because it was also kind of a secret love actually. So now it's not secret anymore, but it's like years later, because I told you now it's in the quilt. But yeah, whenever I look at my Dear Jane quilt, so there's a specific block. I know there's a part of that scarf of that reminds me of my big love. And it makes the quilt very special to me. And the Dear Jane anyhow, it has a lot of different blocks, of course. And when I started it, I wasn't very good at sewing and quilting yet. So you can see the whole process of me getting better at quilting and gaining confidence as a quilting throughout the whole quilt. It's amazing. You can see me. You can literally see in every block getting myself better at quilting. So there are so many ways a quilt can tell a story. So there's no, just allow it to happen for yourself and not stop the process because you don't feel well or you're too tired. Because I feel so refreshed now by quilting for like half an hour. And it's nice because it's a quilt made for my grandfather's stuff. And now it's a quilt that I also associate with getting relaxation. And my grandfather is a very happy guy. So it all comes together. I hope you saw what I've been doing as well. There's one line to quilt. I'm going to tell you one more time how to do it. There's one line left to quilt. I don't know, you cannot see it very well because I refuse to use a bold color for my grandfather's quilt. But as you can see, this line isn't quilted yet. I'm going to talk you through it one more time. You go with your needle with a thread that's about 20 to 30 centimeters. With a knot at the end, you go in between the batting and the quilt top fabric. You go out half a centimeter from the border, and you gently pull your thread through, so the needle, so the knot gets stuck. Then you make a stitch through all three layers, as you can see here, and you gently pull the thread through. It should stay. But it's a tiny knot, so be careful. I usually go back one more time to secure it, but you don't need to. And then you go on. According to the official quilt people, the stitches should be 1 millimeter or 2 millimeter of equal length. But I advise you to stick to about half a centimeter or to make it possible for you, because tiny stitches come with practice and time. And then you just sew all the three layers in the ditch. And we're stitching in the ditch because it's an invisible way of quilting. And it creates little pillows in your quilt. Tomorrow, as I already said,
we're going to discuss a not invisible quilting, which is more of an adornment technique. I'm showing you both. Because stitching in a ditch, which is kind of invisible quilting, is very suitable if the kind of fabrics you're using for your quilt are very meaningful to you. Because if you use a lot of quilting, which is sewing through the three layers in your quilt, the fabrics will kind of stand out less. So if you want your fabrics, for example these bicycles, to be very, very eye-catching in your quilt, you shouldn't quilt too much over it. What you can do is, for example, quilt a lot over the fabric you don't want to be eye-catching, so the eye-catching fabric becomes even bolder. But if you want your quilt to be as calming as possible, I usually use stitching in the ditch, which means that you stitch over the line where the two fabric pieces meet, and then it's sort of invisible, the quilting. You quilt around every 5 centimeters to make your quilt strong. And the amount you need also depends on the use of the quilt. Because if you're not going to use it heavily, you can do less quilting. If you're going to use it heavily, then at least this size of the blocks of the 9 patch is about how close the quilting lines should be. And again, enjoy the sound of the needle through the fabric. When you get to the end, you go to about 0.5 centimeter from the edge. Usually I turn around and finish at the back. You make a knot as close to the fabric as possible. Simple knot. Then you take your needle, you go into the fabric where you left, you go underneath it, in between the backing and the batting filling, and you go up a few centimeters on, and then you pull in the knot, and then your quilting is secured. For a 9 patch, we only have 4 lines of quilting, because there are 4 lines, like 1, 2, 3, 4, and this is the, basically your quilting is done now. And tomorrow I'm going to show you how to how to add adornments to it to make it pretty. But now already you can feel that in the middle a little pillow has appeared. And I invite you all to do the quilting of your quilt. To feel. And to let me know if it calms you as much as it does me. This is the video for today. If you have any questions, of course, let me know as always. I will email you the video and some extra tips. And tomorrow I think we're going to meet around 5, but check my profile to be sure, because I haven't checked my agenda yet, but probably 5. Thank you all for joining, and thank you all for giving quilting a chance, and I hope you all are very well on your way to make a memory quilt out of wonderful fabrics. Please share photos with me, because it literally makes my day if I see a quilt of somebody made with videos of mine. I already got one and it made my day. It was wonderful to see. You're all amazing in the quilts you make. Everybody's quilt is unique in their own way, and that's why I love seeing them so much. I just love it. So send me pictures of your work. You can send a DM, or you can just put it on Facebook or Instagram and tag me. For now, I want to wish you a very good evening, day, whatever. And good luck with your quilting. Ask me questions and share your work. Bye-bye.